God for this morning. God, for all of you, for being here, practicing your mind is regulated, motivated. Amen. How many of you have ever been challenged to do the right thing? Amen. And the fight between you and God. Us asking God, why me, and why are you doing it to me, why I'm going through, and I don't understand this, I don't understand that. How many of us have been that way? Amen. Amen. So I thank God for this morning. And God, Mr. Ben back, he skipped out of the last week. Amen. He had to be with the wife, so we understand. We understand at some point. Amen. Amen. We're going to look at Rebecca 2. Rebecca chapter 2. I want to look at the first, second, and third verse of chapter 2. The Lord answered me and said, write the vision. Oh, let me back. Go to number one, I'm sorry. I had a moment. Amen. Amen. It said, I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower. And will watch to see what he will say unto me, and what shall I answer when I am reproved. The Lord answered me and said, write the vision, and make it plain upon tables, that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come, it will not tarry. Amen. 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 Last Sunday, I talked about weight. I want to use that subject, but it's going to be kind of an indifferent type of thing. God is doing some different stuff with us in this hour. Being that we'll make it. You know, there's a lot of stuff that you have been taught just by coming here. Amen. But then, in the same breath, we have to understand that whatever we've been taught, God gave it to us for a reason. Amen. God didn't just give us something just because we was getting some information. How many of you understand that whatever I know, I have to put into practice? Yeah. Well, I've been praying over this week and trying to see what God is saying to us today. And I was walking. God, what day it was now? I walked 3 miles, and while I was walking, there's a lot of stuff going through my head, but I got a call here, a call there, and shortly after I kept walking and God kept dealing with me. So on Friday and yesterday, I couldn't get Rebecca out of my head. I could not get Rebecca out of my head. So I looked at it last night. And this is, and I'm not going to hurry. You know, we're going to be out of here pretty soon. But I need us to understand it. It said, "And I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower and will watch to see what he will say unto me and what I shall answer when I am reproved." Now, Habakkuk was a prophet. And so, in Habakkuk being a prophet, there were some things that Habakkuk had to understand that God was saying. He had to actually understand what God was saying to him in that hour, because in the first chapter, it talked about how that Israel was going through. It talked about the stuff they're going through. And I think at one time, they got caught in an area, got in captivity in those areas. Habakkuk wanted to understand what God was really saying. And so when that first verse in chapter 2, it actually talks about our callings. It talks about the giftings that's in your life. It talks about how God had purposed something in your life. Now, for every person that will lead people or will give people a word, God has to first set you in your place. Now, what we didn't understand was, why would God set me in a place that I didn't understand? Amen. We oftentimes look at that. We oftentimes set to ourselves, why would God put me in this place? Not only do I not understand where I am, but I don't understand the position. And so Habakkuk had to ask the question. It was like he was wrestling with God. It's like he said, "Now I'm not worthy. I'm not in a good place. I'm not fit." That's what he actually said. He said, "Tell me what you want me to do. You're gonna put me in this position. So now tell me what you got for me." That's what he actually said. And so then he came and he said, "Now I'm gonna take the watch." He said, "I'm gonna get on the tower." And he said, "But I want to see what you're gonna say." How many of you are looking for what God is going to say? How many of you actually want God to speak to you? I'm talking about speak to you in a voice that you can understand, that you can say yes to God. But now, how many of us want God to be so comfortable with us that it's not a challenge to us? I want to get in that place to where I'm just walking in what he said. It don't cost me nothing. It's not getting me in an area. I'm just in that place, and in that place I'm in, I'm comfortable right there. I don't really have to do a whole lot. Well, God will never put you in a place that he don't challenge you in. Amen. God will never, ever put you in a place that he don't challenge you in that place. Amen. Why is it? Well, I kept reading, and it said, "And what shall I answer when I'm reproved?" Oh, that would got me, y'all. That really got me. I looked up that word "reproved," and I said, "What is reproved?" Now, I knew what it was. I mean, but he said that after he corrected me. God of mercy, why do I need correcting if he's going to put me in a place? Well, the Bible says your gifts and callings are without repentance. And so, since my gifts and callings are without repentance, God called me before I was formed. Amen. Let me tell Jeremiah. He said, "Jeremiah, I knew you while you were in your mother's womb. Before you got in your mama's womb, I knew who you were. I had already positioned you."
in the barbershop. I said, my baby girl, she used to get mad at me because I would always talk to them before I whipped them. So Courtney said, Daddy, just come whip me. The talking is worse than the whip. Amen. We're at that place to where God is correcting us. Now, Marvin, the problem we have, we don't want to be corrected. Amen. I wanna basically keep doing what I'm doing without the correction. But Habakkuk said that the only way that I can really see or hear what God is saying, I got to be corrected before I hear it. What sense do that make? Well, a lot of us are not listening as long as things are going smooth. We can hear a few bumps in the road, but I'm really not listening till something stops. And when it stops, I really need an answer. Ben, would you put that air conditioner back on 71 for me, please? Amen. By the power of God. Amen. Amen. Yeah, Alicia told me she was cold. Like, whew. Amen. God wanna get us to a place. A friend of mine the other day told me that his daddy broke his leg. He broke his leg in the woods, and he said he carried him out of the woods and took him to the hospital, and they repaired his leg. But in repairing his leg, it kind of leaned in a little bit after he got home. When the daddy got home, he saw that his leg was leaning in. He said, oh no, I can't do this. He went back to the hospital and he told the doctor, break my leg again and straighten it up. He said, I can't walk with that. Okay. Amen. He wanted it corrected because he didn't want to walk with that leg, you know. Amen. If we're really going to do what God said do, sometimes we need to ask God to break us again. Amen. Amen. I got saved. And I know God, I know I'm saved, but there's still some stuff that keep making me look imperfect. I realize that grace, by grace we are saved. You know, I understand that, and grace keeps, but it's an imperfection that we have that we don't desire. God don't desire in you. And so what Habakkuk said, after he reproved. Do you realize you can get a clear revelation once I'm corrected? And if you got a lot of stuff in your life, you act like some of these bipolar folk. Amen. Because you won't get a clear answer on what God is really saying to you because you got too much stuff coming at you. Amen. God wants to correct those that he put in position because everybody you speak to got to walk where you walk. But if you're not correct, amen. So I kept looking at that thing because, you know, we had a moment in time right now that everybody believes we can do whatever we want to do. Amen. You can't live any kind of way and thank God it's just gonna. No. So Rebecca said, I want to hear what he's gonna say to me. After he reproved me, I want my life right. I want my, now you're not going to live a perfect life, but my mind tells me I want to do what he said. Now, I don't want nobody to get in their mind that because God's grace is sufficient and I don't have to live this perfect, you know, because old folks, you said, if you get perfect, you go into heaven. I don't want you to get in your mind that I can set up some sin on Monday. Because I know he's going to grace me on Tuesday. Don't go get out of your mind. You can't walk in a saved way and understand the perimeter that God has in your life. God said, I got to correct where you are. And in my correcting where you are, He said, I'm gonna do some stuff with you. And so in that second verse, he said, write. Why do you want me to write something down? I'm very peculiar in writing. I write everything down. But now, notice when I said I'm very peculiar, because I'm a peculiar person. I'm different than most folk. Amen. But now, the Bible said we are a peculiar generation. We're the royal priesthood, right? Well, what I need is, when in my writing, I need to structure my life. I can't just get up every morning and just say, okay, whatever happens today, just gonna happen. That's not structured. That's not structured. So I need to structure my life according to the word and the will of God. Amen. I can't see a lot of them got 8-to-5 jobs, and we never think about God. We think about the job. We think about getting there on time. We think about getting off. We think about lunch break. We think about the light bill. We think about my break time. We think about, you know, being okay. Somebody can get on my nerves, so I got to get my mind straight so I can't hear. We think about all that stuff, but we never think about structuring ourselves around God. Do you realize that if I structure myself around God, all that other stuff that I'm trying to not get involved with, God will let me get involved? Amen. The Bible says in Matthew 6:33, it says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things be added. He won't let stuff bother you that's in your way. But I got to structure where I am. If I don't structure where I am, then I can't make it. Now, I don't know how many of you all have ever written a business plan. But if you ever go to the bank, that's the first thing they're going to ask you, do you have a business plan if you plan on starting a business? Because if you don't know where you're going, amen. When we first thought about getting this building, the people that had the building told me to write my vision and my mission statement down and sent it to them, email. They was in Springfield, Missouri. He said, if I like it, he said, I'll see you tomorrow. I'm going to fly down tomorrow. And I typed it out, and I sent it to him. He called me back. He said, I'll see you tomorrow about 3 o'clock. Amen. Because I knew where I was going. Amen. When God starts telling you to write stuff down, you got to know where you're going without wondering. I told y'all I went in the mirror. I need y'all to understand this. See, you can't keep wondering, pulling at straws where you're going. It's kind of like going in the store testing stuff. Well, years ago they take you to jail for tasting grapes. Y'all know how y'all used to walk in the store and then the grapes sitting there, all the grapes sitting there, pulling out grapes either. That's stealing. And he said, I'm going to give you part of the money. I said, no, you're going to give me all the money. And then he said, well, a half a loaf of bread is better than no loaf. I said, but they don't sell half loaves in the store. He didn't understand that. Either you're going to give me all of it. Amen. God wants us to understand that I'm going to give you everything I got. Amen. He's going to give you everything. He wants you to give him everything. Because in your structured life, you got to know without a shadow of doubt, this is what the end is going to be for me. Why? Because I trust God. Now, why is it so important? Why is it so important to write stuff, structure stuff, and then have faith in God when it comes down to my position? Amen. A lot of us don't understand faith. So I write my business plan down, believing where I'm going. That's faith. Amen. Well, how many of us need faith? You know, a lot of people thought, well, if God positioned it for you, or if God gave it to you, he's going to give it to you anybody else for you. You're going to give, you know. But it's going to take your faith. It's going to take your faith. It's going to take your faith. Because, see, a lot of people have faith, but they don't believe in faith. Now that sounds crazy, don't it? Well, let me tell you why I said that now. A lot of people said, I got faith. But when it actually comes down to stuff that's hard, they back up on what they believe. So they really, they must have had no faith. Amen. So what God said is, he said, if you are writing, structure it out, and then believe that it's there. Because he said, write the vision and make it plain. Make it understandable. And what you're really saying is, whatever your passion is, somebody else is going to feel your passion. Somebody else is going to feel where you're going without you even saying it out of your mouth. They'll read it on the paper because they feel what you feel. But if you don't have an idea where you're going because your position is not right, your correction has not been done, then won't nobody else get what you got and do what God told them to do. Amen. Why is it so important? Because my faith operates and makes God do what he said he's going to do for me. Amen. I heard Bill Winston the other day, he said the lady went to the barbecue place and got some barbecue and they gave her a bag. They gave her a bag and she walked off a little piece and looked in the bag and came back to the window. She said, Mister, she said, do bread come with this? Sound real silly, don't it? Amen. But it was. Because whatever comes with your faith, I want all of it. If bread came with the meal and I'm going to pay for it, give me my bread, even if I throw it away. Amen. So God said that if you'll write this down and have faith that you're going to receive what you're going to receive, everything that belongs in that bag is going to be in the bag. Well, what does that mean for us? Well, if you think about it, your life ought to have some peace, it ought to have some joy, it ought to have some healing, it ought to have anointing, it ought to be in the bag. If I'm saved under the anointing of God, I ought to get everything he told me I'm going to get. But without the faith that I need, I don't receive everything because I walk away with the bag because it really don't matter as long as I got something. Well, God didn't just set you up with something. He set you up with everything. Let me tell you. Paul told Timothy, he said, stir up the gift that's in you. Now, it's down in you anyway. Because it's been taught to you. Amen. What actually happens here, because there are no stirring. Amen. Now, be a plain how. Ben, do you ever stir that plain up? Why you stir it up? Because it won't be the right color with it. All that stuff is down in the bottom of the bucket. A lot of stuff, even the stuff that Jasmine cooks at work or cook at home, it won't work if you don't stir it up. So Paul told Timothy, he said, stir up that gift that's inside. And what actually happens, it comes to the top. Amen. Now Jasmine, all that stuff God doing with you, it's coming to me. Amen. And now y'all wonder, how did the stirring come? All that stuff that gets in your life. It's stirring, it starts stirring. All that trouble you think is trouble, all that is not trouble. God's stirring some stuff. Because see, what actually happens in your faith, you believe that God will take you to the next place. Well, if I'm in a situation and I don't believe God can handle it, then I fail where I am. But I don't need to fail where I am. Amen. Because I need to show others that if God be for me, he's more than the world is against me. Amen. So when Habakkuk kept writing, he said, write the vision, make it plain upon table that he may run that readeth it. He's going to run because he's just as excited as you are that he's learned something new. But if you hadn't given them nothing to run with, amen. See, we pray for a lot of people. And in the process of praying for those people, we don't believe the prayer ourselves, we just pray. But that's not a good prayer. Amen. What actually happens in us praying, we're praying that God will move because he gives us authority over this stuff. He told him, I've given you authority over the enemy. Amen. And so when stuff comes in our lives, we just lay hands on or speak to it because he's given us authority over the enemy. How many of y'all ever fought together? Amen. Look at me now. Tell him not today. Not today. Not today. We're not going to. No. He said, write it down that he that reads it will run. Then he said, for the vision is yet for an appointed time. I'm about finished. He said, it's just for a short time. God got a time for you to accept the correction as well as you to accept your calling. He's not going to sit there and just wait on you to say, okay, God. No. I'm going to tell y'all this so y'all know this now. So you think, well, he just going to pull away from it. He's going to say, no. Your gifts are called without repentance, okay? He's going to run from it. Now, you might not accept it when you think you're going to accept it. You might say, well, I'll do it next year. I get myself together by next year. The Bible says that it's an appointed time. It's appointed. Well, now, we didn't appoint it, did we? Like the doctor's appointment, they tell you if you're not coming, they tell you you need to call in 24 hours so they can cancel that appointment. They put somebody in that spot, right? Now, if your appointment is 8:35 and you get to 8:55, they tell you, well, you got to come back another day. But your time is 8:35. How many of you understand what I'm talking about? Amen. Amen. God said this is for an appointed time. Now, time, only thing time does for you is keep you in order or structure. Time don't belong to God. It's just something God gave us to keep us lined up. Now, when the Lord come back and receive us, time don't be needed no more. We don't need time no more. Amen. And so he said this is for an appointed time. And so what we're trying to do, we're trying to accept our callings on our time, or we need to get corrected on our time, or we're going to stop what we're doing on our time. God said, it's for an appointed time, and it would not wait on you. Did y'all about read what my Bible read? Let me read it again. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end of it, it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come, it will not tarry. Now, it said, wait. And then it said, it won't stay there long. Amen. It waited on you, or you said, God said, wait on it. But when it got here, it said, okay, I just got a little time to sit here. I'm going on. Well, God said, I corrected you in the time. You know, the stuff start happening in your life, it just happened. It just. Can't sleep at night. You get kind of discombobulated through the day. Amen. He said, I can't tell you. You need to go and do what you need to do because I'm pulling at you. All you got to do is surrender because I can't wait no longer. I'm at this point. That God is ready to do something different in the body. We've foundationalized the church. We've put people in position. We got people's mind ready to receive kingdom. Now all God is saying here is that, okay, God, I need my next step. I'm in this thing. You've placed me in a position where I need people. Lord, all I need now is instruction which way to go next. Because I'm in this place. Amen. I'm in this place. Adrian, come on. I'm in this place. I'm wrestling in this place. I don't know what to do, but I'm in this place. And God said, this is what God said. God said that I'm going to put you on top. I'm going to let you see some things. And sometimes watching things is not watching people. Sometimes watching is watching what's around you. Amen. It's watching what's around you. It's watching what your area is going to be. Amen. I saw a guy last night on TV. He remade a car. And he sat there and kept looking at that car. And they asked him, said, what you keep looking? He said, I'm trying to get my inspiration. And that's what God does for us, Jack. He let us watch things so we can get our inspiration. Where am I going to be next? Because I do that on cars sometimes. If a car is all beat up and mangled up, I sit there looking and see where I'm going to start first. Because I need to make this as easy as possible. God said, I'm going to put you on a tower and let you watch. And once the anointing comes, he said, your inspiration comes. When your inspiration comes, he said, don't tarry. He said, start writing out the structure. Start writing out the vision. Start writing out what you want to do first. And if you just start writing, I've always noticed that when I start writing what God said, God always give me something else to write that wasn't in my mind. He said, keep writing. And I noticed that my hand get a little faster. My hand get a little faster. My lines get a little faster. I start writing a little faster because what I've done, I started what he told me to start. He said, write the vision and make it plain. Because somebody's going to come back and read your report. What are they going to read? They're going to read how this day, on July the 26th, I accepted what God said in my position. I was already saved. I was already anointed. I was already appointed. But now what I'm doing here, I'm starting what he told me to start my journey. I need my journey started. I need to start running. Somebody's going to read my journey. But he said, if you don't make it plain, what happens is somebody stumbles on what you didn't write out. And we don't need to go out feeling anointing in you. We don't need nobody to stumble on what we wrote out. But what God said is, he said, if I can get to that place to where you can make it to the door, and all I appointed you is for the door, he said, stop at the door. He said, but everybody that I appointed and assigned to you is going to be at the door when you stop. Woo! Can you see what God is saying? Because see, God did not just make us ordinary people in a way. But he made us unordinary people because we got an unorthodox gospel that he told us to stand before. Make it plain because there are some people that got to stand for, but they don't have God. There's a whole lot of people got a word, but they don't have an anointing. There's a lot of people got a word, but don't have a revelation. God said, write it down because I put you in a position that this thing is different now. Yeah, they told me at church a few years ago, this is how we do it, and we're going to put it in this way, and we're going to put it, but God said, I got another way for you. He said, I don't want you to do it that way. Everybody will get kind of casual if you do it that way. He said, I want you to be spontaneous with what I'm doing. And when you come to that, it's going to surprise them, they're going to shock them, and they're going to pay close attention to what you're doing from this point. Because they were looking for the normal stuff. They were looking for, yeah, he got saved and now he's going to church. Yeah, she's speaking tongues, but God said, I'm going to do something different. He said, I want you to start watching your surroundings. If you'll start watching your surroundings, what he said was, he said, you'll notice that everybody is doing the same stuff. The reason they can't get homosexuality out of churches is because everybody's doing the same old stuff. The reason they won't get right at your house is because everybody is doing, when you start talking to somebody, they tell you the same old stuff that they told you 15 years ago. God said, I'm going to do something different. And when I do it different, they're going to start looking at you because what you've done, you've got your inspiration. He said, this is the way the Lord said it to me. And because he said it this way, this is how I'm going to do it. I'm going to walk the way he told me to walk. I'm going to walk in a special anointing. I'm going to walk the way he said. Because see, what he said was, he said, for every person that you save, there's a crown added to you in glory. Amen. Yeah, we're going to get there because see, when we're challenged to do it the right way, when we're challenged to do it the right way, and then Barbara will correct us in our challenge. How many of y'all like walking around with your chest out? So, oh yeah, I done it today. I done it today. I did it. Well, when God challenges you, he corrects you, he lets you stick your chest out. you're saying now is it's not about me, but it is about him. And because it's about him, life got saved by what I said. So now I tell God, I said, God, use me as your vessel. I want to be used of you, God. I want you to take my tongue and I want to say what you say. I want you to take my ears and I need only to hear what you are saying to my ears. Lord, take my mind. Make it what you say. But Lord, when I walk in a place, I want to walk in a place, God, that everybody knows that I'm your child. Amen. I want people to say something different about you. Yeah. A lot of you know that I come from the street. I mean, I've done the drugs, the alcohol, the stuff. So when people see me now, they don't see the old Jeff. They see the new Jeff. Because Corinthians said the old man gonna have to die. And the new man can show up. Yeah. And so they don't ask me. They used to ask me, it's a man, you wanna. No. I remember I used to take it and I'd hit me and come around, you know. Hand the bottle. We did everything with it. But now when I come around, they start to say, man, where you going? They hide. Because what they had now is the anointing is so great, God said, I'm pulling people your way. Now the next time you see them, Jeff, the next time you see them, they won't be hiding the blood. What they be asking is, girl, what did you do? So I know you went to church, and what Jeff was going to tell me, I gave it all to him. I couldn't do nothing with it, so I gave it all to him. And what he did, he gave me a guideline. And when I started writing out my business plan, this is what he said. That young lady going to say, girl, I need to do it that way. Because I'm at wit's end right now. And I don't know what else to do. So I'm going to try it the way you said it. God is saying this to us. If we'll write the vision, make it plain, know where you are. Know where you are. Stop running from where you are. Stop running from what God called you to be. Stop running for what God, position God called you in. Everybody keep coming. I just don't know what I'm supposed to do. I don't know what I'm. Yes, you do. Yes, you do. It's something about knowing when God speaks to you. The Bible says, my sheep will hear my voice and to be only with the answer. You know when God is speaking to you. But the problem is, I'm nervous about to speak to you. Yeah, daddy used to call my name sometimes. And I knew I was in trouble by the tongue of his voice. Yeah, and I walked slow. He said, boy, I had to come get you. Yeah, and that's all God said. He said, boy, if I have to come get you, it's going to be worse him coming to get you. Amen. Because the Bible says in John, he said, if he don't draw you, that means he's pulling you at him. He don't have to come and actually put his hand on you. God said, I'm calling you. And boy, if you don't hear up and get him, God is calling for a nation that will obey. And we're in that day. We're in an obedient state right now. We're either going to do it right or we're going to do it wrong. How many of you are ready to just say yes to God? I just want to say yes. And the Bible says, and I think it's in Isaiah 1 and 19, it says, if you're willing and obedient, I'll give you the fruit of the land. We've been struggling too long. We've been in poverty too long. We've been pulling at pennies too long. We've been working from check to check each week too long. It's time for the overflow to come in your life. Only way I can get it, I got to receive what he's saying. I got to be obedient to what he said. Because he put me in position. He let me watch some stuff. He let me get some inspiration. But then after I got the inspiration, I started writing. My. All head bowed, all eyes closed. Lord, we thank you now. We thank you for what you said this day. Thank you for correction. Thank you, God, that we as leaders of God is having the correction, God, because we need to be corrected in some areas. We had always been good. We had always been what we are now. But even in that, God, we need some more correction. We need to learn how to speak to your people. We need to learn how to speak life into your people. We need to learn, oh God, to speak faith unto your people, God. Continue to correct us, God. The Master, as we walk in faith, believing in you, God, realizing in a few more days, faith is not going to be an option. It's what we're going to walk in. It's what we're going to talk about, God. It's what we're going to live with, God, because we have faith in you. We ask and pray now, God, that you will bless every soul that's here this day. We bless, oh God, those that are not here, God, that those that will listen to us by whatever way they get it, oh God, let them listen and hear what you're saying today. Oh God, we want to be humbled and we want to be honored by you. For every soul, oh God, that's sitting in this place, touch their minds and hearts, oh God, and whatever we need to do, oh God, to pull off, oh God, allow your spirit to pull it off us. We want to be strong and vigilant, oh God. We want to be active in what you're giving us and where you're taking us. We see vision, we see structure, we see building, we see land, we see ministry. Most of all, God, we see your people. We see your people, God. We've been through the struggle, we've been through the fight. We even been through the challenge. My God, we ask again that we'll walk and where you told us to walk. Write the vision. Make it plain. For he that readeth it will run. He'll tell somebody else, I've got a man that told me about everything that I've been through. I've got a man that changed my life. I've got a man that healed me. I've got a man. Look for you on Tuesday. Amen. Have a good day.